situation where when there are so many frameworks, a lot of times it's faster to just write your own and try to learn somebody else's mess. But that's the situation we found ourselves in. And we're hoping to kind of get a little more conversation about this kind of thing happening in the Drupal world so that we can build sites using the same techniques and maybe have our own little framework someday. So to that end, the way that we're kind of approaching building these mobile sites is in a more MVC pattern than Drupal itself kind of uses. So first we'll kind of talk about where you get your data from or how you can model the data coming out of your Drupal site. Then we'll take a look at the templating layer and then the sort of meta controller piece that goes with it. So your first option, since you're just building a regular HTML site at the end of the day, is just using straight JSON to make requests against other APIs that don't even have to be Drupal sites. So in this case, this is just going after Flickr, hitting the Flickr API, and grabbing some pony images. So if you're building just a regular website, it's pretty easy to make a request like this and splice in data from multiple sources. So if you want to do things like mix in images from Flickr because your site doesn't have enough content for certain terms, or you need to hit an ad server and stick ads in the middle of your results, it's just straight JSON and straight JavaScript. That's sort of your first option. It's not Drupal related at all. Another approach is using Drupal JSON output. So it's a pretty handy API function you can use to basically spit out any sort of data that's coming from your Drupal database in custom code as JSON. So again, this is sort of the sledgehammer approach where you write your own queries, you write your own, basically in this project we needed to pass some site-specific variables that were coming from the variable table. So this is how we sent those off to mobile framework. There are definitely some easier and more user-friendly approaches that make sure.
One of which is to use the deep data source model, so you can take the
views. Here's what I built. It's just the sound.
Services module and using services views like this basically means that the ability to add an API for your site is as complicated as configuring a view with this module on, which is pretty neat. There's a really good article on NPR, which is sort of our BBC in America. They put out a bunch of writing lately about create once, publish everywhere as sort of the model for how they're building sites. This is an approach that we're definitely interested in exploring more. But the idea is that your Drupal site, you could basically use field API and kind of content types to build your data model around the admin interface and the editorial workflow. But then when it comes to the front end, just using HTML and JavaScript and consuming a JSON API like this, you basically wouldn't have to touch the Drupal theme layer at all. So you could take any regular front end dev shop or dev talent, build a site according to a certain API spec, and as long as that's what Drupal's outputting, you're sort of good to go. That would even be true across Drupal version upgrades, as long as your API stays the same. So it sort of decouples your front end and back end in an interesting way.
Yeah, so one little tip I'll give you is we'll make sure you put a version number for your API in your form. Your URL. So here are my ONG ponies. You'll see I put REST and then G1. And this will save you later when you decide to go and change your API in your app. And then go and make me too. Yes. So a couple of little pointers for this is that you might have some cross-domain concerns. So by default, your browser won't let you pull in JavaScript JSON objects from other domains that aren't on yours. So for Flickr, for example, you would have to use JSON key, which is kind of a hack, and it wraps your JSON in a function, so when you pull it in, the JavaScript will actually kind of run this function, because the browser will let you run external scripts. A kind of more modern approach is to use cross-origin resource sharing, and that's actually a setting on the server, so Flickr would have to go and turn on, you would have to go and turn that on your server, and then you can configure your app to say, yes, I would like to receive data from this one particular domain, and then you can whitelist it.
It's definitely a preferred approach to JSONP. There was an interesting article a few weeks ago about how Gmail in particular and most of the Google scripts kind of construct their JSONP in a way that prevents other domains from stealing or being able to sort of fake using their account in JSON, which is a pretty interesting read. But if you can go configure your server to accept cores, then you don't have to worry about things like that. So now that we've got our data kind of taken care of and consuming JSON either from the larger web or from our Drupal site, the next kind of layer in this approach will be the views or the templates. So in our case, the project that we were working on, we used a templating language called Handlebars. There's another one called Mustache. Twig, you've probably heard of if you've been keeping up on Drupal 8 at all. Mm-hmm. The basic idea is that you can't write actual code in the template, so you're not doing database queries like you could in a PHP template file. You're not writing actual PHP, so you can't do horrible things like delete directories and go crazy on the server. So from a security perspective, it's a lot kind of cleaner and safer. The other thing is it's JavaScript, so it's essentially a static site. All of our template files were kind of small and looked basically like this, which you could hand off to a themer because the most complicated thing is a loop or an if statement, which is pretty easy to explain. Then we have another kind of compile script that takes all of these and collapses them down into one JavaScript object that you would want to hand edit. But templates like this are pretty straightforward. So this is what Handlebars markup looks like. This is actually a Twig template from Drupal 8 as of a few months ago, so it's pretty similar. Not very complex code, pretty clean to read. Let's get to the next one. There's also, so the last one was a PHP version of Twig. There's also a similar project that's Twig implemented in JavaScript. So you could use the same templating language server side as well as on the front end, which conceivably means that if you built out a Drupal 8 Twig theme, you could reuse that in a static HTML JavaScript theme that gets bundled with PhoneGap as well, which is pretty cool. So the controller layer that we'll take a quick look at, you basically need something to route your menu URLs and keep track of browser history and navigation for you. So one of them that we're familiar with is crossroads.js. It's basically, you can think of it as the equivalent of like hook menu in Drupal. It handles routing URLs to the data structures you're getting in the template files.
If you're familiar with routing in like Ruby on Rails or Zen framework, it's a little bit more similar. It's more similar to that.
Very similar. So I've got some kind of simplified pseudocode. This isn't exactly Crossroads.js code, but it's, the ideas are basically the same. So for namespacing purposes, you kind of encapsulate your app in a JavaScript object. You initialize the router, which basically just says start it up. And then down on the bottom there, you call something like app router add with a path. And that path you can register can take regular expressions. So it could be, you know, node/node ID that you're capturing. And then you can pass that node ID through. After you register the path, then you have an anonymous JavaScript function that basically contains the page contents itself. And we'll take a look at that in the next slide. So inside of that route that gets registered, since JavaScript is asynchronous, you kind of need the skeleton for the page rendered first and go in our page. And then we kind of set up, down at the bottom here, we've got this add block function, which basically, you can think of them just like Drupal blocks, but constructing your entire page out of Drupal blocks. So each one of these blocks takes a template ID name, which is the mustache or twig
size
template.
Sorry to interrupt, could you increase the font size a bit? Can you zoom in a bit so we can see it at the back? Thank you.
So down on the bottom, we've got a call to add block that passes in a template ID, which is the Twig or Handlebars templates we looked at before. Data source URL, which basically just points to the JSON feed that you're getting your data from. That also can contain data type parameters and caching, so you don't have to constantly hit the feed if it's not going to change very often. And then the third parameter is just sort of options, which if you look up at the options object, tells it where to go in the skeleton, so which div ID to append its results to. A preprocess function, which works just like preprocess would in template.php, if you're familiar with Drupal theming. And then a callback function that you can run after the results have come back to the server. So in the case of the project we were working on, we would basically set polling intervals there so that block would automatically go out and fetch the results and update itself every, in some cases, 5 seconds, because it was close to real-time data. So the overall structure of the controller is pretty similar and has a lot of parallels to Drupal theming and Drupal sites.
Oh yeah, so the dreaded live demo. So we're going to show you how you can now take your HTML code and make it something native. So if you download PhoneGap, a big list of all the different devices you can try it on, which is pretty cool. When you grab it, there will be several build scripts inside of it. You're going to have to choose which environment you want to start with. In this case, I have. In this case, we're going to do an iOS app, because I'm on a Mac, so that'll be easy. There's a create script that you run, and then when you run that, it's going to spit out all these files for you. So it will automatically create an Xcode project for you, and then it will create this www folder. And inside that will be a small example application. I've changed it slightly. We'll look at it in a sec. If we open the Xcode project, which is the stuff that's going to connect it to the mobile device. I've used jQuery, I've used jQuery Mobile, and then some custom CSS.
The Provoke script also contains all of the device-specific API wrappers, so interacting with things like the camera and the GPS and whatnot are all kind of documented on the site.
So what I'm doing in this is quite similar to the code you saw in the slide. I updated this a while ago, because originally this was pulling from Flickr, but now we've got it pulling from Drupal. But you can download the code and uncomment them and see how they both work. All this is doing is doing an AJAX request to our ongpony.com. If that works, it does. Yeah. So this is just giving us a feed of everything on our site. So I have one content type called pony, and on there I have a title, a body, and an image, and then I have a bunch of pony stuff. I'm saying that it's JSONP, so I need to just specify the JSONP here. And then on success, I'm going to call the store ponies function, which is going to grab all the data that we got and put it in local storage. If it fails, I'm just going to go straight to populate. So what this does is if I lose my internet connection or the API goes away, then I still have a copy of that data in local storage. So even though they update, we can still serve them something instead of nothing. And then all I'm doing is just forming everything into a grid. So by like this UI block class, these are things that come with jQuery Mobile. It's going to put it out into a nice grid for us. And then I just make a link with an image in it. And then I'm attaching a quick function to it, which is going to pop it up in a new window. And then these are kind of new code that comes with Clover. So it just says, hey, when the device is ready, please can you run my script. The first thing you can do is actually you just open it in your web browser. This doesn't work. It's great. Okay. Oh, it doesn't work in the browser because of the cross-domain stuff. So if you look in the console, it will actually say, hey, can't find it. I'm going to gloss over that. It works in the iOS simulator. So all this has done is shown some ponies. If we look at the source for index.html, this is where we're pulling in all our scripts. It's going to initialize our app, and then I have a grid of ponies. Header saying, oh my god, ponies, and then this little bit here is going to send us back to the page we were on before. So these are all my pony items from Drupal. I can click one, get a pony, I can close it, which is fun. So now if I go to my Drupal site, I can add new ponies.
So obviously this is a pretty simple example, but but the nice thing about it is the front end code is completely separate from the Drupal theme and not tied to it at all. So you can take anybody that knows HTML and JavaScript and throw them at a JSON feed that takes about 5 minutes to set up, and you can do anything you want with content reuse. which, as we were kind of talking about, the million of different devices that are out there, internet-enabled now, it's pretty easy to roll out these kind of custom one-offs or device-specific apps to reuse your content.
I think a big thing. So when I showed you services, I actually disabled the views that I made for that service. So the reason you were still seeing stuff is because I had stored things in local storage so that my users wouldn't get any stuff, but that's really not helpful for debugging.
Have you used Backbone?
We've played around with it a little bit. We worked on this project before it went into core. So we had sort of made our decision already and didn't want to go back and rewrite things. I'm interested in playing around with it more, but I don't have a ton of experience with it yet. My impression is it provides some of the kind of model wrapping pieces that might make this kind of stuff easier, but I haven't played around with it enough to really have a solid opinion either way.
Yeah, I was just thinking that they do a lot of sort of what is called the sort of extra stuff that the backbone would just sync the stuff between the server and the, especially when you write stuff back to the Drupal. I don't know whether the backbone is integrated with Drupal yet, but you would get the everything would be synchronized without you doing any calls.
Yeah,
you just set up the repositories and then data would flow.
I think there is a contrib module that's kind of started along that path a little bit. One of the nice things about the projects that we've used this on, we didn't have to write back to Drupal from the front end, it was just read-only. So that simplifies the JavaScript we need quite a bit. Another one in the back end?
Yeah, I was just wondering about performance with the queries. From the getting the data feed. I mean, obviously, presumably Drupal does some caching of the output. Is there any caching that the device does? Or
yeah, definitely. There's the way we set it up, there was basically a cache time parameter that came with the data source URL, and you could set that on a per feed basis, and that was the local storage cache on the device. So you can cache your JSON feed on the Drupal side. You can also cache it on the device side.
Mm-hmm.
So kind of keeping those two in sync and debugging that can occasionally be a challenge, but the project we were working on, some of those feeds were cached for weeks, some for months, I think, and some we were getting every 5 or 10 seconds. So it needed to kind of vary on a per block basis.
How would you invalidate that?
Hmm?
How would you invalidate the cache on the device then?
It automatically,
if you
said it automatically expires if it's past the timestamp. We also had a couple of debugging functions that we didn't have at all. We invalidated. But the local storage item itself has a timestamp on it.
So you're stuck with the duration thing.
Well,
basically.
Yeah, that's caching. Just to show this does actually work in the browser as well, now I have the feed one. So one nice thing about this unit is with the jQuery UI, you get all these responsive grids and stuff like that. So whatever device can load in some little cool.
To get the view into the services, do you have to set the view format to be a specific format?
Yeah, so there's these two views here, the same item that I built. And you actually get these new blog types.
sending a feed every 10 seconds, and you're not careful about unbinding click handlers, you can actually break a BlackBerry that requires like taking the battery out from the web browser, which I think is kind of cool because I hate BlackBerries, but clients may not agree all the time.
And bear in mind, when you're pulling in these data feeds as well, whatever device you're using, you're going to start using battery life, things like that.
That was one of the reasons we wound up going with Zepto, actually. The selector performance is a little bit more efficient than jQuery's, and the file size is smaller. So both over the wire, kind of getting the Zepto library, and just doing the selector operations is a little bit more efficient. At the end of the day, I don't really think it's worth it, to be honest. It's really hard to measure like JavaScript selector performance impact on device battery life, right? Because everybody's running different apps and everything. I think it was one of those premature optimizations that we didn't really need to go with. But you know, it's the mobile world has a whole different set of concerns around some of that stuff. So learn as you go. We've probably hit our time, so we'll be around. There's so many companies, it's quite confusing.
What are you playing with?
Yeah.
Oh,
that's a good one. No, that sounds bad, doesn't it? Yeah, I do like it. It's it's quite full on because I'm doing a bit of back, trying to learn the back end as well. So it's a little bit like. I know, yeah. I always. Oh, do you? Oh, that's cool. I like this. Where did you get this done? Oh, it's really nice. Did you draw it?
No.
I really like it. Do you have any others?
Yes.
Oh, that's big. That's really nice.
Yeah.
Too addictive.
I think after the second one, we just.
I know, that's it. Yeah. Get carried away. Yeah. I don't really know. Yeah, too early. Is there a toilet nearby me?
I guess there is. Let me
just is it in there? That's fine, I'll find it.
Yeah.
I'll ask.
Best guess is
yeah.
You need to go up.
Do you actually think I'm saying?